What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Joe Bonamassa here. Yes, wearing the same jumper from last week. Here in New York City, this is live from Nerdville. And today, my special guest, I am so honored to have him on the show. Multiple Grammy winner. You know him, you love him. He has played on hundreds of records. An icon of the guitar, Mr. 335, Larry Carlton. Thank you very much for doing this. I'm so honored you're here.
Thanks, Joe. It's been a little while since we've seen each other, but thanks for the invite.
You know, the last time we hung out, we had this, it was a crazy gig in Paris. And we were hanging out, and you were there with John Jorgensen and Robin Ford. And it started with you sitting in, and then we invited Robin, then we invited John, and the people in Paris were absolutely, they're like, what's going on? It's like, oh, ladies and gentlemen, Robin Ford, ladies and gentlemen, Larry Carlton, like, who, you know, but it was something I'll always remember. And it was just, it was such an honor to have you up there, and you're killing it, man. You're killing it. You're playing great. And as always.
Well, thank you. That was an interesting time there in Paris and in France for that tour. John and Robin and myself and Christopher Cross,
right,
a couple other people. We had been booked for like a 6-week tour with 35 gigs or something like that. Well, right. half of the gigs got canceled by the promoter.
Right.
So we ended up with all this time off just hanging out in Paris. It was cool. And you happened to come in on one of the nights that we were off. It was great.
Yeah, it was. I remember you guys saying, like, yeah, we're off for like the next 2 weeks, you know, and you know, that's the one thing about like you can't play every day when you're touring. You need a day off, but sometimes those days off are just so boring. You're just like, you get to the end of the internet, you know. Do you like touring? You know, because I know you, I mean, everybody knows Larry Carlton as being one of the most accomplished session guitarist of all times, but you know, do you like the backpack and the feel of the road?
I do. About maybe 10 or 12 years ago, something mm-hmm. like that, I cut down on the touring to a more comfortable for me lifestyle.
Right.
You know, I moved to out here outside of Nashville, 1996.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, about 10 or 12 years ago, I cut back, and I never toured like you, hundreds of dates a year. For me, a big, big year was 140 dates, and I cut that down to about 80.
Right.
Just by choice, and I'm enjoying my lifestyle with the grandkids and that whole deal.
And you were, you know, you're one of the first people that I knew that moved to Nashville from Los Angeles. And, you know, now everybody is in Nashville, you know, I have a place in, you know, and what was it about Nashville that attracted you to, you know, move from LA to, you know, to the 615 in the first place?
Yeah. I knew in my 30s mm-hmm. that someday I wanted to live a more rural lifestyle.
Right.
I folks from southeastern Oklahoma. So for vacations, from LA to Oklahoma, I was going fishing and wolf hunting, horseback riding. So I knew early on that someday I wanted a more rural lifestyle. So the opportunity came. My children had moved here. So I followed them. 7 months after they had moved to the Nashville area, I bought a place.
And you know, it's still kind of true, but it's the prices of the real estate are going up now. But you can get a hell of a house compared to LA. You know, you know, I tell my friends, like, you drive out into the valley and you're like, that's $1 million house. They're like, no way. It's like, go on Zillow. I mean, it's like, you know, LA's become so pervasively unaffordable that a lot of the, you know, musicians is like, I'm going to go to Nashville. Yeah. And you know, you find that all your friends are there too. You know, it's like, you know, I've lost probably 15 friends in the last 10 years. People moving to Nashville.
Sure. Yeah. No, it's very cool. Yeah, I like it.
So, you know, like everybody, we're all kind of, you know, we're all kind of just sitting at our houses. What have you been doing during the pandemic to A, stay safe? Obviously, you know, you don't want to go out and hang. But B, you know, just to keep creative, keep the chops up, and, you know, are you playing?
Sure. I haven't done a lot of playing. I have a unique lifestyle in that four generations of Carlton family, we all live together in my home.
Wow.
I know. It just wasn't planned, but that's the way the last 10 years have worked out. So my mom moved in with me 3 years ago. She turned 98 this
God
Christmas.
Bless her.
I know. Yeah, from L.A. Mm-hmm. So that's been great. And my daughter and her family with three kids, we all got together and decided to live here at my lake house. So when you say, what have I been doing? I have family to hang out with. We're fortunate. We live right here on a lake, so we can go fishing. It's been okay. As far as music, there's just been a couple of projects that I've overdubbed on, a couple of videos I've done for Japan.
Right.
Promotion for them. Other than that, like you, no live gigs. So I've been kind of taking it easy, tell you the truth.
Yeah, you know, at first it was a real shock to my system being home and with no gigs. And then I kind of liked it. I kind of was like, yeah, that's all right. You know, this is, you know, I'm a little bored, but
yeah. Nice.
You said something, one of my favorite moments. I was, you know, watching a bunch of your videos today, and you played Eric Clapton's Crossroads Festival that 10 or 12 years ago.
Yes.
Yeah, and you came out and you had this great line. Hi, my name is Larry Carlton, and you might remember my guitar, and it goes something like this. And you go right into Josie from Steely Dan. And it was such a, you know, something you sing in front of a crowd, and, you know, just, and I was thinking about it going, you know, if that doesn't just personify Larry Carlton to me as a guitarist and a musician, because I've heard hundreds of records that you've played on and didn't know it. You know what I mean? Because you were such a first call session guy, and you were so, you know, diverse in your style, and you know, obviously everybody knows the Kid Charlemagne and the Steely Dan stuff and the stuff you're really famous for, but it's like Bobby Bland. You played on Dreamer, Ain't No Love in the Heart of the City. That's you.
Right.
You know, do you ever like listen to the radio, you know, just driving in your car and you go, that's a pretty good guitar part. And then you realize that you played it?
Well, not exactly like that, but sometimes I'll be shopping grocery stores at the grocery store, maybe with my daughter, Katie, and something will come over the speakers. It's been a long time now since the 70s and 80s, you know.
Right.
And every once in a while, one will come on that neither one of us have thought about in a long time. And I'll go, something, a session I did that all of a sudden is being played.
Who got you in the door? Because a lot of great session players, you know, like that have had great careers, yourself, Dean Parks, Luke Guther, you know, the Rittenour. There was always a host. There was always somebody like a producer or somebody who got you. Who was like your mentor and like, come here, kid, come play on this thing for me.
Yeah, the one that comes to mind today, there were a couple of guys that kind of put my name out. But Louis Shelton told a story, and he was the number one pop guitar player in L.A. in the 60s and 70s. When I was about 20 years old, I was playing an after-hours club. And by chance, these two guys came in. It was Louis Shelton and Dash Crofts.
Right.
And they heard me play, and Louis remembered me from that night. And so he told this story. He was on a David Cassidy and the Partridge Family session.
Right. With
Tommy Tedesco and Howard Roberts, something like that.
Yeah.
And after one of the sessions, David kind of pulled Louis aside and said, everybody's great, but do you know any guys that play a little more like you, like a little more contemporary? And Louis said, I remember this guy. And Louis called me and said,
wow.
Could you do some Partridge Family sessions? And that was one incident where somebody recommended me because they had heard me play a year or to before. Yeah.
You know, the thing about like all those television bands, you know, like the Monkees, Partridge Family, you know, those shows in the 60s, they were A-level musicians and great songs. You know, the Monkees had great songs. The Partridge Family had great songs, you know. Yeah. And you know, it was like the Wrecking Crew. Did you find any resistance, you know, because there's those stories about Howard Roberts. He was a little, you know, and some of the, you know, the Barney Kessels of the world that were kind of being phased out by the late 60s, early 70s. And then the new, you know, the new younger, you know, more contemporary players were stepping in for the same gigs that they were just getting three times a day. Do you ever find, is there any resistance?
As a overall general rule, no.
Right.
A few times you could feel a vibe from much, much older guitar players. If we ended up on some kind of a Streisand date or an Andy Williams date that was legit,
right,
you feel that, like, why is the kid here? You know, I was 22
right
when I started session. So, but nothing major, a lot of respect. And also becoming friends with those guys over the years, then we got to share our perception of each other from the beginning.
Right.
It was great, but you know, nothing but nice things to say about, yeah, you were the kid coming in, but we could tell you could play. That kind of embracing.
Right. Yeah. There's always, you always get the they look over the glasses at you at first, and then, you know, it's like that, and that's your moment to prove yourself. You're like, oh my God, you know, it's like, you know, I got to play today, you know. What was your studio kit back then? Like, because there's that legendary Tweed Deluxe that's been on everything that you know, I think you still have it.
I do. I still have the Tweed Deluxe, but honestly, I only used that amp on the Steely Dan solos.
Right.
Prior to that, the typical studio setup was a Princeton Reverb.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And everybody started having them modified to make them cleaner, blah, blah, blah. But yeah, Princeton Reverb and a guitar of choice was pretty much the session guitar set up in the early 70s.
Yeah, because you could, with a Princeton, you can basically do anything. You know, if you want clean, reverb, it's bright, it's nice. You know, and the thing of, you know, when I listen to the solos on the Steely Dan stuff, and I obviously am a geek and a nerd, and I have this little jazz funk band, and I said, you know, we did the first record, and I said, I got to do the Larry. So it's the front pickup and it's the Tweed Deluxe. And it's just, you turn it up to about 6 or 7 and, you know, and roll the volume back. And it does that. Obviously I'm not Larry Carlton, but it got the vibe that I was looking for. Do you remember how much you paid for that amp? This would be a good.
And I don't even remember why I bought it or where I bought it. And it sat in my home for many years. And I don't even remember, Joe, why I took it to the Steely Dan overdubs. It's just a fluke. You know, it's like, now I'm going to take this one too.
How many takes would they make you do? Because there's those legendary stories about like it takes 6 weeks to find a chair that you're comfortable with in those in those sessions, you know?
I wouldn't remember this except Donald or Walter. Mm-hmm. Over the years have told me, but Walter told me that the night we were doing Kid Charlemagne, when I got to the studio, he suggested, now this is Walter telling me, I didn't remember
right.
it. He suggested maybe I play a Strat.
Gotcha.
So I pulled out a Strat and we plugged in, got a little sound and played some stuff. And he said, after a couple of run throughs, he said, nah, go back to your guitar.
Right.
And then they reminded me that Kid Charlemagne was 2 takes.
Wow.
Yeah, put together.
Right.
Through here. No, pick it up. Let's finish it.
Right.
I've reflected, obviously, over the years about those solos, Kid Charlemagne, Don't Take Me Alive. The planets aligned, man.
Mm-hmm.
Right player on the right song on the right night.
Right.
And then you can't plan those things, you know. It just worked, and I'm humbled and thankful that I was there to do it.
Well, you know, that's what makes classic music is, you know, there are so many great guitar solos on average songs. Is if you get a great song, great singer, great band, and then you nail it and all the pieces come together. It's timeless, you know, and, you know, that particular solo for me was my entry into like jazz and because I was a blues player, but I wanted to get into the adult chord business, you know, where there was multiple changes. And I was like, oh, I can't just play F sharp over this pentatonic. You got to know the changes, you know, were you good at sight reading when you were doing those gigs and those sessions?
More than adequate. Okay. I wasn't a great sight reader like a Tommy Tedesco, you know, but I always got by.
Mm-hmm.
I remember doing some film calls and there would be three guitars, me, Tedesco, and Dennis Budimir. And I would always take chair three because that would be the easiest reading. There was no ego in me in that. And I'd go through the music. Oh, shit, there's a banjo part. It's just scattered with eighth notes, you know?
Right.
So when it became time for the 10-minute break, every hour the union says the band gets a 10-minute break, I would sit and skull, make sure I could nail the part. Then the guy would come back in and they'd add coffee and a cigarette. So I always made it, but I wasn't a great sight reader, just good enough to always get the gig done appropriately.
You know, Tommy Tedesco had a great line. He had all these weird instruments. I remember watching this interview he did, I think it was GIT. He's like, I had a bouzouki, I had a jaras, I had a sitar. And he goes, I just tune them like a guitar. And then if the producer asked me to, you know, he would, you know, what was he like? Because, you know, he was from upstate New York. He was from Buffalo. And just, you know, I never met him, but he had that upstate New York Italian character that it just was endearing to me. And then just, you know, and then to be that good and to, you know, people still talk about like his contributions and to just popular music. What was he like to like work with? Was he as advertised?
Oh, he was fun because he was Italian.
Right.
Fun, right. And so accomplished that every session he was just relaxed and he loved to tease everybody. So he would always, if I was on a date with Tommy and it was a reading date, of course, he'd take chair one, I like whatever. And maybe the producer would say, okay, guys, in a minute, let's do a take. And Tommy would say, I bet you $100 you can't make it all the way through without making a mistake. Because I was the kid.
Right.
He enjoyed putting that kind of pressure in a fun way. Or let's switch parts and see who makes a mistake. That kind of fun.
So, right.
Yeah, he was a joy. And one other incident that comes to mind. After I was established a couple of years in, Tommy had a dinner at his house. Mm-hmm. So he invited me and my wife, Joe Pass, John Paisano. Who else? Dennis might have been there. Anyway, there were four for sure guitar players plus Tommy. And then he had an Italian dinner for everyone.
Right.
I was probably 23 years old. My heroes are all sitting here and I happen to get to be one of the guys.
Right.
So it's an Italian dinner. So it's going to be at least five courses.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. They brought out the pasta. I thought that was dinner.
Right.
And they watched me. Everybody ate their pasta, but I probably had seconds. You know what I mean? I didn't know.
Right.
And then Tommy and I got to, because then they started bringing out the second course and the third course. And I thought the spaghetti was dinner. So Tommy teased me about that afterwards, you know, next session was like, hey, how'd you enjoy that first course?
Yeah, that's the thing. You got to watch it because the pasta comes out first, then the meat, and then there's like, it keeps going. Well, you know, we've all been in Italy, you know, before the promoter wants to take you out for dinner and you're like, you know, hey, we going at like 9, you know, we're still at the restaurant at 7:30, you know, there's no intentions of wrapping up in the next hour. know, yeah. it's just how they roll, you know. What makes a good producer? Because I always have this conversation with a lot of people, and, you know, I always, in my limited experience in sessions or whatever that I've done on the side, I always say indecision is the worst kind of decisions that a producer can make. Like, if they just don't know what they want, and you're like, well, you know, we're fishing without a lure here. It's like, you know, are we going for bass? Are we going for trout? You know, and then you try to bring the right kit to cover all the bases. But, you know, if you're just play something, you're like, I don't know. You tell me, nudge me in the right direction. What's your definition of a great producer and what they do?
Well, I would start with saying their relationship with the artist and what they have in mind for the artist to accomplish. Do they want to make something very artistic? Do they want to make something very successful?
Right.
Bottom line, I think it starts there, but then I can reflect on being in the studio when they've already chosen the song, they've already chosen the arranger.
Right.
So the producer, I heard Quincy, I'll paraphrase, but I heard Quincy Jones a long time ago say that producing a record is like producing a movie. Casting.
Right.
Call the right cats that you know fit a certain scene.
Right.
And direct them, but allow them to bring to that scene their personality. And it works a lot of the time. You handpick the guys you think would be right for this moment.
Right.
So that's one I think a lot of producers could do now for sure. Think very carefully about who you're going to call, because you know what they can contribute.
I have tempo fear. I've produced a couple records in my life. I have tempo-itis, right? Because the one thing you can't fix is the tempo. Is it grooving? Is it too fast? Or is it too slow? And I do notice on some of the older recordings that I try to jam along, they're in between keys, meaning they've sped up the tape machine a little bit or brought it back a little bit to where, you know. Right. And, you know, one of the things that I always notice about your playing is even if it's a simple part, I know it's Larry Carlton. How do you, I mean, even when you're working with Streisand or the Partridge Family or Bobby Bland or Steely, you know, are you cognizant of like, you know, I want to, you know, leave my stamp on this, on, you know, on this tune, or do you just go, I'm just going to give you what you need and then pack up my stuff and go?
There's not that much thought that went into it. I was there to give them the guitar part, and that's just the way I play it. It was never about me trying to make a statement so somebody will notice that's me. It was just the way I play the guitar. Yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, like going back to Ain't No Love in the Heart of the City, your part is almost as loud as the lead vocal. You know, your rhythm.
I think that's me and Dean.
It's you and Dean. Yeah. Yeah. And it's you and Dean part.
And I'm playing the rhythm part, I think.
Right. You're playing like you're playing the slidey chords. And you listen to the mix. You're like, my God, whoever mixed that record loved that part, because there's Bobby's vocal. Your rhythm guitar is just tucked right underneath. And then the rest of, you know, Dean's kind of buried and panned to one side. And it glues the whole song together, you know, because it creates the groove. Speaking of the blues, I have to ask you about the trip to Kinshasa, Zaire 74 with the Crusaders, or the originally called the Jazz Crusaders, but they were Crusaders at that point. And you backed up B.B. King on one of, I think, the definitive version of The Thrill Is Gone. So much so, I covered your version for my tribute show to B.B. King because I love it so much. I mean, just for the viewers, set the scene. I mean, you've got this gig, you fly to Central Africa. Okay, Larry Carlton exits the plane. What's the scene like for those living vicariously?
Yeah, there were two places to stay. One right in the heart of the city, at the major hotels, the five-star hotels and all that. Right. And then there was an out-of-town, 5 miles out, another place where, and that's where the Crusaders and I and many other artists stayed. And my suitcase didn't show up, so I had no clothes for 5 days. So
nice.
I was borrowing T-shirts from Styx Hooper, the drummer in the Crusaders, right. and just making it work. So anyway, that was one incident.
Right.
But musically, we were thrilled to be there. It was a lot of downtime. It wasn't very well organized, and it was all about the fight, obviously, Foreman Ali.
Right.
And yeah, just one afternoon, somehow somebody said, BB needs a rhythm guitar player. He'd like you to do it. I said, sure, because the Crusaders, I don't know if we had already performed, probably.
Right.
Probably. So it was just one of those casual things that I was there. They needed a rhythm guitar player, and they asked me to do it. It was a thrill for me.
Oh, yeah. I mean, and, you know, I watched that film of BB, you know, and he's in 74, he could do no wrong. He was on fire. He was a pop star at that point. I mean,
yep.
The Bill Simzik produced Thrill Is Gone was a huge hit. He was up there with James Brown. He was one of the premier black pop stars at the time.
Right.
And he knew it, you know, because he's doing the shtick. It's the Sweet 16 where he'd fall down to one knee and stuff like that. And it took me a couple of like passes to watching this concert. And I go, my God, I know that's Larry Carlton there, you know? And did you rehearse with him, or was it just, here's the music, we'll see you on the other side?
Probably a run through in the afternoon before
gotcha.
The show. Yeah.
Right.
Now, another thing I do remember enjoying so much about BB, that performance, he was playing through an Ampeg VT-22, and his tone, I loved. I remember that. I never forgot that. I came home and thought, I'm on one of those amps. Yeah, I enjoyed him having a little more grease on it, you know?
Yeah, you know, BB's tone, when I was a kid and I first met him, he liked my twin. Because it was healthy and it would overdrive. So he'd plug it in, you know, because the band never carried backline. It was we were the opening act. We used our drums, everything. He loved my twin. And I always used to love those gigs because he would embrace the feedback, you know. Because some nights it would just be the twin was lame or whatever. And it just was like plunk, 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 plunk. And still him, but it wasn't the, you know, speaking of amps, you're known as a Dumble guy, and you're using Bluto tones now, which are great amps as well. How did you meet Howard or Alexander, whatever he wants to be called? But you know, did you hear about the amps, or did he find you, going, hey, check this out?
Yeah, prior to meeting Alexander Dumble, I was playing boogies live.
Right.
I had been on tour with the Crusaders around 73, and we did a show in San Diego. And at soundcheck, a local music store guy came to soundcheck and said, hey, I got this new amp. You might want to try it. And it was one of the first boogies.
Right.
So I bought it on the spot, paid $750 for it, and bought it and used it for a long time. Jumping ahead, I heard about Dumble, but I'd also heard about his reputation of not being so reliable.
Right.
And that his amps could only be worked on by him.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't want to get in that boat.
Right.
So time went by. And I remember getting a call one evening from someone. I'm sorry, I don't remember. And they said, Dumble's over at someplace in the valley.
Right.
And they sure would like it if you'd come over and check out one of his amps.
Right.
My cousin Steve, who was my assistant engineer at the time, we went there.
Right.
And then there was this guitar player playing through one of Dumble's amps that I had never heard of or met. One of your heroes, as a matter of fact.
Right.
It was Eric Johnson.
Right, right. Eric Johnson, right, yeah.
It was Eric.
Yeah.
So we met that night. And shared some experiences and played through a Dumble. And I loved it. I really did. thought, this is great. But I was honest with Alexander Dumble afterward. I said, man, here's what I've heard. I can't get in that boat, but I would love to play your amp, but I just can't. He said, if you buy the amp and love it, I guarantee you, mm-hmm. I will always take care of you. And he did. I could be in Japan and have the amp go down and ship it back, and he'd have it back in 5 days.
Wow.
He took great care of me at that time.
Right.
So it worked out, and I enjoyed playing that amp for a long time. The amp went down one evening getting to Bluto Tone.
Right.
At soundcheck in Colorado, and just by chance, he was there, the Bluto Tone guy.
Brandon, yeah.
Brandon, he said, I can fix that for you. And I can duplicate it if you ever want it.
Right.
And he fixed it backstage before the show.
Right.
So that was the Bluto Tone connection. And it got me out of the Dumble situation, which my amps were getting tired.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Dumbles were getting tired. So Bluto Tone relationship started.
You know, it's that's the thing, because, you know, you kind of like, you know, play a certain type of amp. And, you know, I have three Dumbles, and I have one guy, Brandon sometimes works on them. I have one guy gets under the goop, and, you know, and this is all geek talk, ladies and gentlemen. Don't never talk about this stuff on a first date. You'll never get a second one. Anyway, but the thing is, I find if I plug into your rig, unfortunately, I sound like Joe Bonamassa. And if you plug into my rig, you sound like the legendary Larry Carlton. And one of the things, a good lesson to have is, as a guitarist, is like, this is the sound. What you plug into is kind of is the toolkit that helps you get there, you know. And I would assume as soon as you plugged into the Bluto Tone, you're like, yeah, I sound like Larry Carlton, you know.
Yeah, it sounds like home, feels like home. And it's funny that you mentioned it's the player and the amp. Two of our heroes, Luke and Robin,
right?
I have done that on stage with them, either at soundcheck or during a show. We switched guitars, switched rigs.
Right.
I took a guitar to Robin's rig, he mm-hmm. took his to mine, and we played, and it sounded like shit. The tone was not there at all by our touch. And Luke and I did it one night on stage, might have been at a master class, and we asked guys from the audience, who's been playing longer than 6 years or something?
Yeah.
You come up and play. What guitar do you want to play, mine or Luke's? We did that whole thing. Each guy that came up sounded, Luke's guy sounded like Luke, and Larry's guy sounded like Larry.
Right.
And they got to play through our rig.
Yeah. I like to do that too. Like, you get a kid and be like, hey, kid, you ever played 120 dB? Try this. Here's all four of them. And you know what it is? It's you do start to see how tactile the instrument is, and you know, all this. There's been years and years and years and years of arguing about the magic pedal, the $100,000 Dumble or whatever it is, whatever they cost now, and it really sometimes distracts from the fact that you could literally, when I hear you play acoustically, just unplugged. It's your touch. It's the way you make the guitar bloom, and it doesn't have anything to do with the amp. It's the technique and the years of trial and error, you know. Do you subscribe to the 10,000 hour theory? Do you know what that is? You got to be doing something for 10,000 hours before you get the expert badge.
I've heard of that. Never gave it much thought, because like you, I was so young when I started playing guitar. My 10,000 hours came
right
along the way early, you know.
Who put the guitar in your hand in the first place?
There was an old acoustic guitar with no name at my grandmother's house.
Ah.
And my mom could play 5 chords.
Right.
And so she could strum and play some chords. And they told me, my parents told me, that at 4 years old, I was just fascinated by the guitar. And so they told me, when you're big enough to hold it, you could take lessons.
Right. So
at about six and a half, I could hold that big old acoustic guitar.
Right.
I started taking lessons, and that's all I've ever done is play the guitar.
And when did you know you had it? Because there's a moment where, yeah, you play, you take lessons, and then you're like, okay, I can do this on a higher, I can run in a higher plane, you know, and then obviously you made the decision to move to Los Angeles and start your career.
Yeah, it was never a conscious decision because it all happened so naturally.
Right.
I knew I would be speaking with you today, and I was running over in my mind some things that might come up. When I was in ninth grade, junior high school, I was working Friday night, Saturday night, and Sunday afternoon at a club playing pop music
with
guys that were 20 years old.
Yeah.
So I was already, you know, I'm 14 years old at that time, and I'm playing three nights a week gigging.
Yeah.
It was never a realization of, oh, I'm It was, I never, Joe, I thought about this, man. Motivation for musicians.
Mm-hmm.
Never in my mind as a kid and through my adulthood did I ever say, I want to be a star.
Right.
Never. I wanted to be a guitar player.
Right.
And my dream was to be like Wes Montgomery, Joe Pass, Kenny Burrell, sit in speaker clubs and play jazz.
Mm-hmm.
That's not the way life turned out.
No.
The last thing I wanted to do was become a studio musician. I had a few sessions in my mid-teens, demos, and it was with the Wrecking Crew, surf music. And I saw these guys all pale, sitting there playing their gig. I thought, I never want to do that. Life ended up doing like 500 sessions a year forever. So you can't plan it. Yeah.
Wow. I mean, what was the session you turned down that you regretted? Do you have one? Just didn't have time, or you were booked somewhere else, you know?
Well, yeah, there were many sessions that I was called for that I couldn't do, and they became hits, but I never regretted it because it was covered. You know the Johnny Rivers record, L.A. Reggae?
Mm-hmm.
Well, Dean and I were booked for five nights to do that, but one of the nights I had another session already on the books, and that's when they did Rockin' Pneumonia. Dean played a great solo on that. It was perfect.
Right.
I shouldn't have been there.
Yeah, it all happens for a reason. You know, it's like it's that folklore. What advice would you give? Because I know there's a guitar player in Los Angeles. His name is Mason Stoops. Really good, plays a telly. Ooh. And he was over at my house one day, and I asked him, I think he's 26 years old, and I said, man, what are your goals? You know, just, you know, what do you want? He's like, man, I want to, you know, my goal is to move to Los Angeles and be a session, you know, guitar player like a Tommy Tedesco or Larry Carlton or Luke Thurn, all that stuff. And he's working really. What advice would you give to a 25-year-old Larry Carlton just showing up in L.A., wanting to, you know, make his mark on a session? You know, or the session scene.
Sure. Well, a couple of things come to mind as far as you never know what you're going to be called to do, but always service the song. It's not about you. It's obvious that a lot of guys go in thinking, if I can show this producer how good I am, no. How good did you perform for the song? And then getting along with the other musicians, another obvious one. And Luke and I have talked about this forever. Leave your ego at the door.
Right.
All you need is play chick.
Right.
Play it perfect. So those two things and the musical part, there's no way to always be prepared for what they're going to ask you to do.
Yeah.
So you just go in and do the best you can based on your history as a musician. And it will work sometimes, and sometimes it won't. I've been replaced on records. I've had records come out that I knew I had overdubbed on.
Mm-hmm.
Comes on the radio, and I'm thinking, I play. Oh, no, that's Louie.
Right.
They dumped my part and brought Louie in. They liked it better.
Right.
So none of us do everything perfectly all the time.
Yeah, you can't. I mean, you can't. Like get hung up about that, you know, because like you said, you check the ego at the door and it's like, hey, they pay me to be there. And, you know, I always tell people, like, you know, like if they ask me to do something, like, listen, I'll do anything you guys want. Like the, you know, you want in time in tune percussion, I'll be that guy, you know, every two and four. And, you know, and to me, it's like, you know, I'm always, you know, cognizant of like, if it gets too far out of my comfort zone, I'm like, listen, I won't charge you for the session. You know, right. I may not be the right guy for this. If we're, there's just certain, I'm a blues guitar player. And that's a real good thing for people to hear. It's like, not, you know, from somebody so accomplished as yourself that you weren't for everything, you could play everything, but then there was, you know, producer go like, no, bring so-and-so and fine.
Right, you know? I'm not feeling the guitar part, man. Let's try, and they move on. It's not personal.
Right. Yeah.
In fact, just before we started, you and I were just hanging out for a minute. I told you I hadn't played the guitar for 4 months.
Right.
Starting in April. Well, there's a project going on that I'd been asked to overdub some solos on here at my studio.
Right.
And I finally got around to doing 3 takes for the guy. But for the first time in my career, because I hadn't played much at all this year, when I sent it to him, I said, man, if for any reason you don't think you can't make this happen, mm-hmm. I've been real scattered. My chops are not what I always like them to be. I hope it works, but if it doesn't, feel free, buddy, just to say it didn't work this time. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the first times, but it's because I haven't played much this year at all, and I want the project to be the best it can be.
Exactly. Again, last but not least, I have to ask you, because as a vintage guitar nerd, there's, if you listen to the internet, they will say 335s from 1965 back to 58 with the wide neck, those are the ones you want. And then anything from like 1966 to the early 70s, oh, that they got the narrower neck, and no, you don't want those. And I always, my reply, I go, you know what? Good enough for Larry Carlton, good enough for me. And your guitar, the iconic, it's like Cherry Sunburst 335, is, I believe, a 1969.
Correct.
And you have moved the earth with that guitar. And is there, do you prefer the skinnier, the narrower nut, in general?
I do, because I'm a chord guy.
Right.
And when I audition a guitar, if somebody says, here, check this out, tell me what you think, there's a certain B flat 13th chord starting on the 6th fret. Mm-hmm. And if I can't make that chord on that guitar, then that neck's not appropriate for me.
Right.
Certain voicings that on the big neck guitars, I wouldn't be able to perform. So it was important to me to get that sound and be able to play voicings that I want to hear.
Yeah, I'm the same way. I don't like big necks either, because it's like you have a 2x4 that, you know, and I don't hear the difference in the sound, you know. Yeah. I mean, I unfortunately, you plug up, it sounds like a 335. Sounds like a Tele or whatever.
Right. Well, there, one cool thing before we end, mm-hmm. one cool thing I did want to bring up, though, because we're talking about the 335.
Yeah.
I've been a Gibson guy for a lot of years, and you are.
Yeah.
Recently, I've started to endorse and have my own guitar line with Sire guitars.
I read about that. I meant to ask you. Yes.
Yeah. At this stage of my life, mm-hmm. a lot of what I do is about giving back if I can.
Right.
And with Sire, you know, they have the Marcus Miller bass, and they have had it for, gosh, going on 10 years now. I mean, the credibility is really high. When they showed me the quality of the instruments they could make to my specs, mm-hmm. the price they could make it, I thought, this is cool. I want more guitar players that want to play a 335 style or a Les Paul style that don't have a lot of money.
Right.
To have a quality instrument.
Yeah.
So I'm just putting it out there. That's my motivation. It was nothing against Gibson at all. But if I can get more guys a quality instrument for the buck,
right,
I'm with them. So that's why I'm on fire.
You could rule the world. Hound Dog Taylor ruled the world with a guitar you wouldn't pay $50 for. You know? He just made it work, you know. And tell the folks, like, how many models are there? Obviously one based on a ES-335. Is there a Les Paul one?
Yeah, there are three solid bodies. Mm-hmm. Similar, yeah, they're Les Paul and Strat style. Mm-hmm. Similar to tone to those. There's my 335 style, which is an H7, and also an acoustic that we did. It's very, very similar to my Valley Arts acoustic that I played for all those years.
Right.
Yeah, we have a 5-guitar line. Thanks for asking that. And again, quality instruments at a reasonable price for the guys.
Exactly. You know, and we every year we do these Epiphone guitars, and they're $799. And yep. You know, they're attainable. You know, and they sound good. I use them live. You know, yeah. I use them live. Yeah. Side of somebody buys it. Yeah. But it's the more people in the guitar business, the healthier the scene is. You know, it's encouraging to see a lot of young people who are light years ahead of where I was. Like, these are 20-year-olds and they're like playing at like master level. I'm like, well, my job's about to be obsolete in a couple of years. So just think about
that's what people said when they saw you. In your youth, you know, they go, oh, watch out for that guy. So,
I don't know. Okay. Thank you, Larry. You're a superstar. I'm honored to be your friend. And I'm glad you're doing so well. And when all of this is over, we got to jam and play something. We got to dust off the cobwebs and play, you know.
I need it and I'd love it. Thank you.
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, the iconic Larry Carlton, thank you very much. This has been live from Nerdville, from New York City, New York.